normally I'm not a conference or seminar person. But since I received this invitation from Selco, I cannot say no. And I also felt that this is a good opportunity to share some of our experiences inside the Tata Trust. So since the topic is on replication, I actually would like to zero in on two of the programs which we are doing currently in the Tata Trust. I'll say the programs are designed by us, to large extent executed by us, and also monitored and managed by us. So just to give a background of the Tata Trust, I am sure that many of you are familiar already. So there are several Tata Trusts and around 12 of them, and this all the Tata Trusts are combined together, and we work in various thematic areas across India. So the major thematic areas are rural livelihood and natural resources management, health, education, society governance and human rights, media, arts and culture, and urban poverty and livelihood. And also we have cross-cutting thematic areas like technology and innovation. So in the field of rural livelihood, since 2007, we have been focusing on how to improve the productivity level, particularly for small and marginal farmers, so that their household level food security can be achieved. And for that, we deliberately work in rented area, mostly in Central India Tribal Belt, Eastern India and Northeastern India. And there, within this focus area, we developed two programs. One is on system of rice intensification, SRI, and the other one is diversion-based irrigation, where water is brought by gravity and provided for irrigation to farms, typically to around 50 to 60 hectares of land in a hilly undulating terrain. So I'll elaborate our experience of replication of these two models in detail. So I just wanted to, because I was requested to talk about little bit of theory also about replication, and I thought that replication and diffusion are almost similar, and among many of the theories and definitions scholars have given, one definition which I have come across and liked very much was of Ralph Litton, when he said that it's about diffusion is about presentation of new culture or cultural elements to society, acceptance by the society, and then these elements become part of the culture. So we faced in both the programs, SRI as well as DBI, these particular elements coming up very, very strongly as we progressed. And also there have been many scholars who have given theories of diffusion and theory of innovation and diffusion or replication. 1935, Gabriel Tarde's finding of innovation taking shape but within a timeline, getting into certain level, and then particularly within a tipping point or takeoff point from where the innovation takes off and becomes replicated. And then in 1960s, E.M. Rogers came up with this beautiful theory of innovators being divided into four different categories: early adopters, early majority, late majority, and laggards. But what is very common among all these theories we realized was knowledge is important part for replication. Unless the knowledge is dissipated to the farmer or to the household, it doesn't become a replicable model. After the knowledge, persuasion is important. and a decision to be taken and influenced either by external agency or internal mechanism. And once the decision is taken, implementation of the decision, and then once implementation happens, confirmation of the theory or confirmation of the technology. These elements are essential part of the replication model or whatever model we work on. Now I like to go on to the SRI model on which we started working earlier. In all these two programs we have worked, we are working still in rented areas which are inhabited by small and marginal farmers. In India, 85% of the farmers are small and marginal, but in our context it will be more than 85. And many of these areas don't have good cultivable land. Most of the areas are hilly. Majority of the land in a typical village will consist around 70% of the land will be upland and 30% will be either medium upland or lowland. So the fertile land available for agriculture is also very, very limited. So I do not want to get into the details of what is SRI and etc., except that I would like to try to simplify the technology so that it becomes easier to understand. And then I would like to get into details of how it was done, what were the challenges, and how we could reach out to the target, whatever we said, or we could not reach out to the target. So system of rice intensification is basically just rice cultivation method, but radically different in the sense that here we do transplantation of the seedling, and instead of 3-4 seedlings, we only take one seedling, which is aged between 8 to 15 days. And it is done in line-to-line sowing basis, a space of 25 cm into 25 cm is maintained. The ideal situation is the land should be alternatively wetted and dried, which in rented conditions we could not achieve in all the conditions, I would say in most of the conditions. And then before cultivation, 3 types weeding operation is done in the field. In our case, it has been mostly mechanical weeding, and a weeder has been shared by 7 to 10 farmers in a typical village. So it results into, in our finding, we had done 3 evaluations at different time, independent evaluation. It gives 40 to 60% incremental yield of our conventional method. Next. So far we have invested around 85 crore rupees in this program since 2008. And in the first phase, when we started in 2008, our experience was based on 2 watershed projects we funded in West Bengal and Jharkhand. There, as part of watershed, the SRI was taken up by our 2 implementing partners, and we saw good results, and there was discussion about some models to be taken up for replication, and SRI was chosen as one of them because we saw encouraging results in these 2 projects. So we tried to develop a program whereby only SRI can be implemented in different locations by different agencies. The principles being the same, whether you do in rented condition or in irrigated condition, in coastal zone or in mountainous area. So we thought that geography may be different, but the model remains the same. So it becomes ideal model for replication, because if the technology keeps changing in a big way from one place to another place, it becomes difficult to make the replication repeat. So with that objective, we started with a dedicated funding of 11 crore rupees in 2008. And before the funding was done, an expert committee consisting of ICAR scientists and social scientists visited these two locations in Purulia and Gaya, and they came up with certain observations. And on the basis of these observations, our honorable trustees were convinced to take it forward. So we started this program with the funding allocation of 11 crore rupees. Then we started to reach out to the NGOs who were interested to be partnering with this program. The identification of NGOs were done on the basis of their experience in the field of community mobilization first, track record of community mobilization. Second was their experience in the field of agriculture. Even if it is not a kind of 10 years of experience, but at least some experience of working in agriculture field. So we decided to have a nodal agency in one particular state. So this nodal agency has helped us in identifying the NGOs in different states and different districts. And the nodal agency's role was to give technical and managerial support and also organize various meetings and conferences so that they could influence the people who matters for in terms of policy, in terms of mainstreaming the program. It actually took quite an interesting time for us because in 2006 and 7 we were with two NGO partners, which is the highest number of 161 partners. So this 161 NGOs typically work out like this. In Uttarakhand, for example, we have one nodal agency. The nodal agency works with say 7 NGOs in Garhwal region, 8 agencies in Kumaon region. So it becomes 16 to 10 partners like that. So if you see, we could reach out to 10 states that our numerically in the highest level of presence, and number of NGOs was 161. But interestingly, when we did analysis, we also found out that the penetration per village was in average 5 farmers. So we thought that if we are actually interested for replication, replication particularly by farmers themselves, from one farmer to another farmer, without giving additional resources from the trust or from the NGO, it was very important for us to at least create a critical mass in those particular villages where we were present. So we make a new strategy and we decided to actually reduce the geographical spread and rather try to concentrate on what we decided as our hotspots. And so gradually we actually reduced the number of NGO partners as well as number of geographies. Can you go to the next slide? It's quite interesting because the outreach of farmers under our program kept increasing, but our number of partners kept decreasing. And at the same time, what we have observed, because we did independent studies done, was that in the beginning it was around 5 to 10% farmers within the SRI village or in adjoining village who were adopting SRI after learning it, because SRI basically is nothing but new knowledge. So, and by one farmer from another farmer without much of technical support. But later on we found out that when we started concentrating and giving more intensity in a specific village or specific block, this self replication by farmers themselves was much more. So it actually went up to around 25%. So we did also sampling analysis of 5,000 farmers, and we found out what are the advantages of SRI over the conventional method and etc. So I'd like to skip this part because in India, typically the debate happens between pro-SRI and anti-SRI, and pro-SRI people always try to justify by giving this kind of figures. So for this particular, I think discussion, this is not so important element. So I would like to rather focus on the experience of application. So as I was mentioning, we started with pilots, then we reached out to more number of farmers, but we concentrated on geography. We also, in the current phase, we also have started seriously thinking about adding up more services, because if we could disseminate the relevant knowledge to the farmer, then probably the farmers themselves can replicate. So we have now set up agro-service centers in the geographies we are working, so that these agro-service centers could reach out to more number of farmers and etc. In Bihar, in our second phase, we tried also to promote SRI in revenue model. So it was actually successful in the beginning, at least in terms of farmers getting excited about it, getting them registered by paying money before the cultivation season. But unfortunately for us, 2009 and 10 and 2010 and 11, both consecutive years, we witnessed severe drought, particularly in southern part of Bihar, Nalanda and Gaya part. So that failed. Next. So our experience has been that if one technology has to be replicated, the model has to be perfect. Model in the sense, the outreach model. For example, selection of the nodal agency at a state level was very, very critical. We also realized that many agencies which are very, very good in implementation of their own projects may not necessarily be good in collaborating with other agencies and creating a network. We also realized that having a strong MIS is very, very essential. So in fact, all the 1.5 lakh farmers currently we have each farmer's name code given and 41 different parameters on which information is collected. And we do take 5% of this sample and do detailed analysis. Now we have engaged a third party agency to go and check independently in various places. At least particularly the yield information which we are getting, whether it is nearing to the information we are getting or not. Another visit, particularly in the beginning, was very, very important, particularly by the farmers from one village to another village, from another district to another district. So we could not make exposure visits across the states except for Jharkhand and Bihar. But in other states, these exposure visits were very useful, from say Kumaon region to Garhwal region and etc. We created lots of audiovisual materials, lots of leaflets in many languages, starting from Manipuri language to Uriya language, Bengali, Hindi. We also, in the current phase, we also realized that if replication has to happen, it has to be taken up by the mainstream agencies, particularly the state government. And agriculture being a state subject, it essentially the state government which takes a call whether this kind of model should be replicated by their own mechanism or not. And there the state agriculture universities play a very crucial role, because normally any new technology comes, the department will send a letter to the state agriculture university, you give your recommendation whether it is good or not. So in the initial stage, we felt lots of resistance by the universities to get involved officially, formally, for any research activity in SRI. In fact, one check we got returned 5 years back from one of the prestigious agricultural universities in Eastern India. But right now, we have been able to create a network of universities which are doing SRI research program funded by Tata Trust. So these are Indira Gandhi Agricultural University in Raipur, Central Agricultural University Manipur, OUAT, Odisha University of Agriculture and Technology, Bhubaneswar, and IGA Research Center in Patna. So this is in the second year, so we hope that they will come up with their independent review and etc. Whatever is positive, whatever is negative will be made clear, and hopefully the government will take up the positive aspects. We did lots of advocacy, particularly in some states. For example, in Bihar in 2011, the Chief Minister declared Bihar that 2011 as SRI year of Bihar. So under the agriculture program of the state government, they put up a target of reaching out to 30 lakh hectares of land under SRI. So that was one of the achievements by our NGO partners here. So we realized who are the stakeholders and tried to work with them. And while we were working with all these nodal agencies, we also realized that it was impossible for the Tata Trust to manage this kind of a program spread in so many places, far away from Mumbai, Mumbai being in the western corner of the country. So we decided to create a secretariat. This was placed in Bhubaneswar, which was centrally located. And we, afterwards, we realized that the secretariat has to take much more activity than only SRI engagement. So we registered this secretariat. They became an independent body, registered as a trust called Riverlink Foundation. So if you go to riverlink.org, you will get lots of information about SRI. There is another website dedicated, SRI, sddd-sri.org. So all the information about our program is available there. We also collaborated with NABARD, and in the second phase, we dedicated actually 24 crore rupees from the trust to for replication of SRI, and NABARD agreed to match the same grant amount, 24 crore. And they put SRI under, to be promoted by NABARD under their Farmers Property Transfer Fund. And our own assessment is that they actually exceeded this 24 crore rupees, because in various states, depending on the chief general manager's interest in that particular region, they took lots of initiative. Particularly in Jharkhand, they took much more initiative for at least 4 or 5 years. Next. What was our learning? After 3 years, we realized that all these NGOs were having their own system of extension. Although we wanted to give that flexibility, and we realized that extension mechanism will depend heavily on various factors like rainfall, land texture, land size, population density, and etc. But we realized that unless we have a uniform system of extension, the replication was becoming difficult and more complex. And so we decided that there should be at least conceptually a common system. So at the lowest level, there are farmers, and in many places these farmers are mobilized into a group, and these are, in many places these are self-help groups, and for several self-help groups there will be a village resource person as the cutting edge extension worker. Typically this VRP covers, depending on the geography, 200 to around 400 farmers, and on top of that there is a farmers club or village organization backed by a group of VRPs, and they are mentored by what we call skilled extension worker, and then 3 to 5 skilled extension workers are anchored by one subject matter specialist or technical resource person. So this is the model we tried to replicate, but we learned this after 3 years of our attempts in various states. Next. Quickly, I can also go through this experience of replicating diversion-based irrigation. So diversion-based irrigation is very simple method of tapping water, typically in a non-perennial stream, either the water has to be blocked by creating a mud kind of structure. We don't create concrete structures, or we create a very simple what we call wire in engineering term to divert the water. And the water is taken by PVC pipe and brought into lower elevation level, and we provide 3 to 7 or 8 different discharge points where water comes out, and typically from one discharge point about 5 to 10 acres of land is irrigated. And it's very cost effective, because typically one such project, including agriculture component, which we have kept 20% of the irrigation infrastructure cost, plus implementation cost and human resources cost, it actually amounts to around 5 to 6 lakh rupees. The only variable here is the length of the pipe, because the location of water resource can be in different places, in different villages. But the cost typically comes to around 3 to 5,000 rupees per acre, which is much, much below than any even minor irrigation scheme. So this is the representation of how the irrigation system works. So there is another system which is not by PVC pipe. Can you go to the next? On which we have also worked. So the understanding was that we are not creating anything new, because these kind of systems were already there in many places, and these are all well documented. And we were in most of the cases trying to revive this system. So in case of Bihar and Jharkhand, we also worked on this Ahar pine system. And in Nalbari and Baksar districts in Assam, we worked on Drong, what they call, the plain people call it Jan, and the tribals in the hills, they call it Drongs. So there we don't put PVC pipes. It is about a stream to be diverted from their main line. You have to take a parallel to the stream another channel, and from there you take to one storage thing, which is called Ahar in case of Bihar, and then you irrigate. So typically here from one scheme we can reach out to multiple number of villages, unlike in PVC pipe system. So these are the two major systems of irrigation on which we have worked. From various states where we have worked. Next. So we did an independent study of three states in Orissa, Assam and Maharashtra, and we found out the impact of the work we have done. So the profit from the irrigated area has actually increased in many of the places. In most of the cases, the farmers were able to take a second crop. Earlier it was monocrop, they were depending entirely on kharif, and in kharif they were either taking a cereal crop or something else. But in the rabi season, in most of the cases they were taking cash crops like vegetables. So they could sell their second crop to market. And there has been also change of cropping pattern, which we have observed in those villages. Next. So there again, we have so far spent around 60 crore rupees. We have allocated in three different phases 85 crore rupees for this program. So we try to reach out from various states to the agencies which can actually provide at least the irrigation infrastructure cost, particularly in Ahar pine and Dwang system, because typically the PVC pipe cost is the critical element in other places. So in many places our partners have been successful, particularly in the second phase, and that has given lots of confidence to us to take it further. So in the third phase, what we are trying to do is the entire command area, say 40 acres of land is covered in a typical village. Instead of you know, doing a flood irrigation kind of. Flood irrigation is when you get water, you just take by conveyance system to the plot where you are doing agriculture. We are trying to bring in more efficient agriculture component like drip irrigation, so that the water can be used much more judiciously and the production can go further up. So this is one element. The community has been demanding that, particularly after the second phase, that now irrigation is done, which is fine, but we require much more interventions like drinking water in all the places, and actually electricity are major issues, because almost all these villages are interior villages. These projects are typically in the districts of Kalahandi, interior part of Nayagarh, particularly one interior block called Ronpur, Malkangiri, Navarangpur, in Churadangpur, in Bukhrul, Baksa, Nolbari, rural Kamrup. These are the places where our current projects are on, and if you go by even any human development index, you will find that these districts are very, very backward districts. So we have now also decided to go for drinking water supply, safe drinking water. How to integrate safe drinking water, on which we are working with Tata Projects Limited in Hyderabad. And they have come up after 1 year of experimentation with their low cost model, which we are going to implement now. It has been tested in 3 villages in Odisha. So these are the new components which we have added on this particular program. So we can skip this because these are similar as. So what we have realized during this programs is that reaching a tipping point is very, very critical for a particular farmer to continue interest in this new technology. So we have observed, for example, around 25% farmers drop out in our SRI program. The farmer adopts the technology in the first year, but in second year they drop out. And when we try to realize this, one of the very, very important elements we have found out was that if a farmer, in fact, in the first year, the average land site which was put by farmers for SRI was 0.18 acres. So we realized that if our objective was to increase food security level at the household level, we are not talking about state level or national level, because typically these farmers have food security of 4 to 8 months in a calendar year. So to increase that by 5 to 6 months, the farmer, even if we go by incremental yield of 50%, the farmer has to put at least half of acre of land under SRI. So if that amount of land is not put, and the farmer is actually putting, typically in the first year the farmer puts the worst land available to him, normally where he doesn't do any cultivation, saying, okay, let's do some experimentation in, and I'm going to put this land. And the size is also very, very important. The size is not big enough. So they feel that it's not making any significant difference, even though yield increment is much, much higher. So we insisted later on that wherever a new farmer is coming under this program, the farmer has to promise that he will at least put 50% of 0.5 acres of his land, half of an acre of land, under this program. Otherwise it was becoming very, very difficult. But then we typically found a problem. For example, in Uttarakhand, we found out that it was practically impossible for a farmer to put that much of land under SRI, because if you have to get half of acre of land in Uttarakhand, the land will be scattered at least in 5 to 6 different locations, and the land size is so small that it was impossible for a farmer to go from one place to another place to do SRI in the same season. Particularly when they have to do this transplantation, they have to wait for rain to come and etc. So we realized that typical tipping point has to be identified. Even in our debate program, similarly, if a farmer is not getting, now we have put a cap of incremental income of 75,000 per annum. If we are not able to provide that amount to the farmer who is coming under our DBA program, we are saying that let's have a relook into the strategy. So that is very, very crucial. Otherwise, all these systems are put, money is put, after a few years, it will become redundant. And the other element we have realized is that although it is easy to make the farmer understand how the technology works, how SRI works, or how DBI works, and etc., it is very, very important for him to realize, for her to realize, why it should work. Because how part becomes easier, but why part doesn't become very, very deep rooted, and after a few years, 1 year or 2 years, they just give up. As I was mentioning, in case of SRI, it was important for us to associate with research institutions. So with lots of persuasion, we could convince at least some of the interested. First challenge was to get good professors, interested professors to get into this research. Otherwise, if professors are not interested, why they go to the university? Typically what happens is university will just conduct a research and come up with a paper. So we found out the interested professors. The professors may be neutral, may be biased against SRI, but the professors should be interested to understand SRI, to work on the aspects of SRI. So we found out such professors, so we are hopeful that they will come up with critical review of our SRI program. And another important element we have realized was we alone, Tata Trust alone, irrespective of how much money we put in and etc., it is impossible to reach out to even 5% of the population of the country with any new technology. So it was very important for us to work with other stakeholders, create an ecosystem. So we worked with various agencies. We reached out to National Food Security Mission, we reached out to Planning Commission of India, we reached out to NABARD, all lots of players, all the agriculture departments in at least 6-7 states where we work. And for us, the encouraging part was in many of the states, SRI became a mainstream agriculture component for implementation by the state governments. It is another story whether this was properly implemented like many other government schemes and etc. But in many, many states, Bihar, Orissa in particular, and Uttarakhand, the SRI became part of their district agriculture plan. And the most important part, learning for us was, it is very, very, it is different to work with, totally, totally different ball game to work with small and marginal farmers, particularly in backward regions where normally market doesn't work and market does not have any interest. For example, we realized that for irrigation bureaucracy, it is almost impossible to accept that an irrigation scheme can be implemented at the cost of 5 lakh rupees. So any irrigation scheme for typical departmental view is multi-crore project. So it is very, very difficult to convince at least the state governments that these are good viable projects. You can do small projects, environment friendly projects where you don't have to burn fuel and etc. But we found out very difficult, at least at the mainstream level, to make it acceptable. Although many of the programs like Orissa Tribal Livelihood Project 40LP, they have replicated this. Our partners, particularly in Assam, have been successful in leveraging money from MGNREG for earthwork, particularly for the Dong and Jan type of irrigation system. In SRI, actually no market player gets benefit because we are promoting SRI and encouraging farmers to go organic or at least reduce the consumption of chemical fertilizers. So chemical fertilizers don't have any interest. Typically in 1 acre of land for SRI, for conventional agriculture, we need HCs of around 30 kilos. And here it is almost 10% of that. So chips companies will not have interest. So it is very, very difficult to link this kind of projects with market. So the challenge is how long and how big we can write off the cost of extension of such technologies. Thank you.
My name is Srikant. Sorry, I came late, but the SRI just raised my antenna. We are also, since about 6 to 7 years attempting to see SRI and SRI principles, systems of rice and milling machines working, it's an economic practice. In wheat, in sugar cane, pulses,
right. We're
trying to do that. Since you are deeply involved and have a pan-Indian experience, what is that limiting the scaling, notwithstanding the government support is there or not, in spite of very evident advantages?
First of all, we should be honest enough to accept the fact that we can't implement all the 6 principles perfectly in SRI. Particularly the alternate wetting and drying is difficult to be implemented in rain-fed conditions, where your agriculture is totally dependent on rain. Because rain will come, then only you can transplant and etc. So I think it's important to demystify and make it simple to the farmer. If we keep on explaining the technology too much and say that unless you do all these 6 principles, we are not going to support you, that should not be the approach. That is at very, very basic level. The other one is why it's not happening, it's not upscaling. Particularly is that I would say we have not been able to create a critical kind of impact in one particular geography. I can cite an example of the state of Tripura, where we have not given grant for implementation, but we have given grants for organizing various policy level meetings and etc. Where around 30% of the total cultivable land is converted into SRI. And government has taken very, very proactive step to incorporate SRI. In the beginning, they also used to provide incentives for taking SRI per acre basis. It is called Khani, they call. And they have reduced it over a period of time. But number of farmers has not been reduced in that proportion. It is actually either constant or it is increasing. So I think its combination cannot be only kind of one intervention which will make it more upscalable. It is combination of factors like the awareness level at the farmers level, at policy level, government taking proactive step, but perfect step. I think there are lots of dilution of SRI program launched by other state governments I would not like to name them. It has become more like how to receive the subsidy, saying that I have done SRI. So I have seen government-run SRIs, programs where not a single SRI principal has been followed up, but they claim it is SRI, and they actually got the subsidies available under SRI program. So if we can make these programs more perfect, I think upscaling should not be a problem.
Asking around replication, I was quite interested to see in your SRI efforts, you actually moved from pilot to working in 11 states with 100 plus NGO partners, and then you actually chose to scale it down. You stated your reasons in terms of penetration levels within each village as being the reason. But I had two questions around that. So somewhere you worked with 100 NGOs and you brought that down to 18. So what happened to the remaining 80? Two, is this really only a function of resources and financial resources going in, or was there something else that happened in those 5 states where you worked with the 18 NGOs, where with the same amount of money as you were putting in earlier, instead of a penetration of 5%, you were seeing it go up to 20 or 25? So that would really be useful lessons for us in terms of saying what did you do differently at that stage that led to that greater penetration levels, greater awareness levels if you want, and so on.
Like I was mentioning about each farmer being tracked under our program. So the geographies from where we have withdrawn, we are not tracking the farmers anymore. We have not been able to. But many of these NGOs are in touch with us. In fact, some of them are implementing other projects funded by us. So we get a sense of what is happening there. And in many of these places, I would say about 50% of the cases, roughly speaking, the farmers are continuing. It has not increased in terms of numerical penetration, but in those geographies, it is continuing in 50% of the cases. On your second question, when we decided that we would like to concentrate only on some intensive districts and states. So our experience has been that because the partners and the network, the state level network, was able to concentrate only on few geographical areas, they could concentrate also on other work. For example, the policy level dialogue became more frequent. They could reach out to not only agriculture officers, they could reach out to say district collectors and etc. And they were better placed, I would say, to go to other donor agencies saying that we are doing covering this much of this many of farmers. So whether you can come and cover and try us to saturate in this particular geography. So for them it was an easier proposition for further replication, either from policy angle or funding angle.
And I had a question about, so when you said that, you know, the government is very important, a very important stakeholder in scaling the entire project. So you had a set of MIS systems that you had already developed, and you had your own resources that were testing all of these things, collecting information, etc. But when you moved it to the government, what were some of the challenges that you faced? And also, are those MIS systems still in place? Are you getting all the data that that you
Yes, my personal view is that when we created the MIS system, we were heavily influenced by the productivity factor. We were very keen to showcase that in our program, actually production goes up, and then thereby it is economically viable proposition. So I think creating MIS itself has created some limitations. For example, many of the things you can't, the qualitative things you can't capture in MIS. So we are still continuing with MIS. I will not say that all the information coming through MIS is 100% perfect information. because it is coming essentially from the implementing agency, checked by the nodal agency. In many places, what we also been able to do is when the crop cutting happens on sample basis, people from agriculture department go there and they give certificate also. To your first question, whether it has been helpful for us to convince the state government. State government, in wherever it has been easy for us to convince, has not been convinced merely on the basis of MIS. MIS was one of the things. Fortunately or unfortunately, even today, if you do a kind of search for literature available on SRI globally, 90% of the research papers are on agronomical, variations and production and etc. There is very, very little on other aspects like extension, and because extension is very, very important. So I think where the state governments, particularly in states like in, I would say Bihar was very, very kind of bright story for us when in 2011 they said 2011 ER is SRI ER for Bihar and etc. It was also, I think, aligning with the willingness at that point of time of the state government to take up new innovative projects into scale. So there is a context, because this Bihar Rural Livelihood project, which got started some years back before this 2011 SRI launch, I would say, had already worked in 5 districts. They had piloted certain agricultural components. They have formed SHGs in many in those districts. They were also looking for upscaling their program. So SHGs already formed, and through SHGs, promotion of new technology was probably a right platform and right time for them to launch such programs. So I would imagine that there would be many state level or local level context on the basis of which they were convinced. And of course it is also related to resources they have.
Solved many of the issues, but there is a dilemma about upscaling or replication. When we upscale, naturally that has been the thing, as in your SRI program also, the quality of the program goes down. That has happened in even with our SHG programs. Some of the NGOs started the SHGs and government took over, and each Anganwadi teacher was asked to create about 3 to 4 SHGs in that village. The target was given and so many. Now the program is sustained. But then initially when you upscale, the quality goes down naturally. Because from the original agency to the next, the quality goes down. What is the solution for that?
I agree with you, and I don't have any ready-made solution for that.
No,
definitely not. What we have tried is actually we wanted to streamline the extension system. Now, whether one ERB covers 50 farmers or 200 farmers or 2000 farmers is entirely to be decided by the implementing agency there. They are the best people to judge for that. But what we insisted was some of the systems, for example, extension system for SRI is very, very critical. We have to put that in place. So we were insisting on system strengthening part to ensure that quality doesn't go down.
With the experience that you had with the farmers, like you stated, some challenges like the size of the land or rain-fed conditions. So were you also able to come up with like some set of standard criteria based on which you would select your farmers who should do SRI or something like that?
As I was saying, that after 3rd year, we realized that unless the farmer puts 0.5 acres of land, it's not really going to give that tipping point. But further to that, we did not insist so much. As I was mentioning, that what happens like in state like Uttarakhand, it is practically impossible to actually insist on this point and say that unless it happens, our fund will not go there. And also typically in many villages what happens is there are many farmers who have land only in upland where SRI probably will not be appropriate, or they don't have land at all. and they have very, very less land in the lowland area or middle land area, which can be put under SRM. So although we have put some basic principles saying that unless we do these, it is going to be difficult, we will continue to face these dropout issues and etc. But we really did not put a kind of military kind of saying that unless this happens, we are going to stop.